Section 1 of Practical Etiquette, Etiquette by Cora C. Klein. Section 1. Preface and Introduction. Preface. The very extensive sale of Practical Etiquette, a sale that has required the issuance of a large number of editions of the little manual, has been very gratifying to its author, as was also the commission of its publisher to rewrite and enlarge the work. This commission, however, brought with it a keen sense of responsibility, for the author feels that a new work on etiquette can find a raison d'être only in a fairly successful attempt at answering practically every question that can arise concerning social relations, at least in ordinary social life. But to speak with authority on all matters of good form is to speak dogmatically, and so to speak is in itself not good form. Nevertheless, and in spite of this dilemma, the author has attempted herein to decide, when compelled to do so, between conflicting opinions in mere matters of social custom, and has given as authority the opinion that seemed to her to conform most nearly to common sense, embodying such opinion in an unqualified statement without citing authority. Fortunately, social customs are now so nearly uniform in all parts of the country that one familiar with the ways of good society in the West or in the North is at home in good society in the East or in the South. The author is under obligation to so many persons for suggestions and advice, as well as to many authors, that it does not seem best to give a list of the same, especially as such list could be only a partial one, for many of her friends would not desire mention of their names. N.C. December 1, 1899. Introduction. True politeness is to do and say the kindest thing in the kindest way. If civil law is the outgrowth of regard for other people's rights, social law is equally the outgrowth of regard for other people's feelings and convenience. Social law is kindness and goodwill and the desire to be agreeable codified. A system of so much importance cannot be unworthy of consideration. The very essence of good manners is self-possession, and self-possession is another name for self-forgetfulness. Gentility is neither in birth, manner, nor fashion, but in the mind. A high sense of honor, a determination never to take a mean advantage of another, and an adherence to truth, delicacy, and politeness towards those with whom one may have dealings, are the essential and distinguishing characteristics of a gentleman. Quietness in all things is an essential element to a well-bred person. He shuns all outward display of his personality. He cares not to be seen or heard. He eschews noisy and grandiloquent talk. He avoids showy and noticeable costumes. His voice is low, his words simple, and his actions grave. He holds himself habitually under restraint. His words never seem to vibrate with emotion. Habits are said to be good or bad as the result of actions that are right or wrong. A man of good habits is one who has for so long a time practiced right thinking, speaking, and doing, that he acts properly from force of habit. Good manners are not to be put on for particular occasions, like fine clothes, but they should be one's second nature. The simpler and more easy and unconstrained one's manners, the more he will impress people with his good breeding. Affectation is one of the brazen marks of vulgarity. End of Section 1. Chapter 1 of Practical Etiquette by Cora C. Klein. Chapter 1. Introductions, Calls, Cards, Visiting. A beautiful behavior gives a higher pleasure than statues or pictures. It is the finest of the fine arts. Emerson. Introductions. In introducing persons, one should be careful to pronounce each name distinctly. When either name is not perfectly understood, a repetition of it should be requested of the person making the introduction. When introductions are given, it is the man who should be presented to the woman. When two women are introduced, it is the younger who is presented to the elder. For example, in presenting Mr. Jones to Mrs. Smith, it is Mrs. Smith's name that is first mentioned. The word introduce is preferred to present. Informal introductions are given by merely mentioning the names, as Mrs. Smith, Mr. Jones, and this is ordinarily sufficient. In introducing two sisters, the elder is Miss Smith and the younger Miss Virginia Smith. When two women are introduced to each other, it is not necessary for either to rise. A bow and a smile from each is sufficient. A woman does not rise when a man is presented to her, unless he is very old or is a person of great importance. Upon being introduced, a married woman may offer her hand to a man, but it is not customary for a young woman to do so. It is the duty of a man who attends a private entertainment to have himself presented to every member of the family whom he does not know. An introduction in the streetcar is very bad form. One should never forget that it is difficult, almost impossible, for some people to remember names and faces, and that such people actually suffer from their inability to recognize and call by name persons to whom they may have been introduced recently. It is not uncommon to see one approach such a person, offer her hand, and say, if there is not an immediate recognition, "I am afraid you do not remember me," while the person approached stands in agony and gradually makes an apology for her poor memory and asks the name. One who is truly polite, who is at all thoughtful for another person's feelings, would not be the cause of such a scene. She would prevent it by saying, "I am Mrs. Smith. I had the pleasure of meeting you at Mrs. Brown's luncheon last Thursday," or something of the kind. Whenever one has reason to think his name or face may have been forgotten, he should make himself known in approaching another person by giving his name at least. Calls. A first call ought to be returned within a very short time. A lady, when receiving, rises as her callers enter, and they immediately advance to pay their respects to her before speaking to others. A man takes any vacant chair without troubling the hostess to look after him. A man rises when women with whom he is talking rise to take their leave. Women calling do not rise unless those who are leaving are friends older than themselves. When taking leave, one ought to choose a moment when there is a lull in the conversation and then take leave of the hostess, letting one bow include the others in the room. 1 month after the birth of a child, a call of congratulation is made by acquaintances. A call of condolence is made within 10 days after the death, if the caller is on intimate terms with the family, or within a month if otherwise. Calls of congratulation are due to the newly married and to the parents who gave the invitations to the marriage. A man invited by a woman to call upon her cannot, without great discourtesy, neglect to pay the call within a week. A lady will never keep a caller waiting without sending word that she will be in immediately. One ought always to return a call, but if the acquaintance is not desirable, the first call may be the last. Some women only rise when their callers leave. Others accompany them as far as the drawing room door, but it is always polite for a hostess to accompany her visitors to the front door when they take their leave, if there is not a servant on hand to open the door for them. The best-bred hostesses even go so far as to accompany their callers to the elevator in a hotel or an apartment house. Of course, if one has more than one caller at a time, it would be discourteous to leave the others to accompany one to the door, but otherwise it is rude to permit a friend to go to the door alone and get out as best she may. A bride who is at home after November 1st should make a point of literally staying at home for an hour or two every afternoon during the month of November and the early part of December. She should be dressed to receive callers and should have some dainty refreshments ready to serve, tea and sandwiches or cake. After the first week of December, the bride may begin to return her calls, calling first on those who first called upon her, and so on. When the at-home is a large and formal function, with engraved invitations and all the accessories of hired waiters, an elaborate repast, floral decorations, etc., such as a debutante's coming out, a wedding reception, or a reception to celebrate a wedding anniversary, and other large entertainments of this order, an after-call is obligatory. But an ordinary at-home does not demand another call, for instance, the reception or days a bride has on her return from her wedding trip, or when she is settled in her new home. or a tea or days for which a hostess informally sends the invitations written or engraved on her visiting cards and receives with little ceremony and serves only a modest menu. On the contrary, the hostess owes a return call to all who attend, and only those who were invited but were unable to be present are in debt to her. The length of time proper for one to stay at an at-home depends on circumstances. It is always a compliment to one's hostess to make a long visit at a day, for it implies that one is having a pleasant time. But nobody should stay long enough to be a burden on the hostess's hospitality or to detain her from her other guests. If one finds that she does not know anyone present, or if she is not introduced to a congenial person with whom she can have a pleasant chat, it would be wise for her to leave after a conventional 10 or 15 minutes call. The calling code demands that soon after a second caller is announced, the caller who was first present shall take leave of the hostess. The reason for this rule is obvious. Visitor number one has already had a little time of uninterrupted tête-à-tête with the hostess before visitor number two appeared, and he or she should generously retire first, so that visitor number two may have the same privilege. But while this is the law, it depends somewhat on circumstances whether it is always carried out. If the first caller is an intimate friend of the hostess and has come to have a long informal talk with her, and the second caller is merely a formal visitor whose obvious intention is to make a ceremonious visit, then the first comer may, with perfect propriety, outstay the other. Or if the hostess has particularly asked the former to remain until after the latter goes, he may do so. And of course, if the first visitor has come for some special reason, and the visitor who is announced later interrupts an important conversation, which, for business or other reasons, should be continued, the former is naturally justified in transgressing the calling code. All things being equal, however, it is the place of the first comer to be the first goer, and one must have a very good excuse for outstaying a caller who comes later. Guests who are invited to attend one large reception, which is given for the express purpose of introducing a young woman into society, should make a call after the reception. But if the debutante is introduced at a series of days, the callers need call but once on one of the days. An invitation to any kind of day or reception demands a card from a person who is unable to attend the function, and the card should be sent on the day of the reception, even if the invitation to the function has been already answered, and even if an after-call is in order. When one calls on an acquaintance who is staying with a relative, the caller should ask for the latter, the hostess, even if she does not know her, and she should leave one of her own and one of her husband's cards for her, as well as one of each for her friend. It is not obligatory to leave two of her husband's cards for each woman. Even in the most formal visiting, it is optional whether one leaves one or two cards. Probably the hostess will excuse herself altogether, but the caller must show her the courtesy of asking for her. In making a call, it is proper to give one's card to the servant who opens the door if it is not a regular reception day. But on such an occasion, the card should be left either in the dressing room or on the hall table in passing out. In making a formal call, 10 minutes is quite long enough to stay. When one is returning visits and driving, it would be in very bad taste to have the coachman get off his box and take the card to the door. It is the woman's place to deliver her card in person, unless she has a footman to attend to it for her. In making an evening call, a man should appear about 8:30 and remain an hour. Even if his visit is to the daughter, he should ask for her mother. It is quite proper, when making calls with a friend, for one to write her name in pencil on her friend's card, if she has no card of her own with her. Those women whose households are most modest find that the day at home is a great convenience, since, having a special time for receiving one's friends, all necessary arrangements can be made beforehand, and no embarrassing situations are apt to occur. When one calls on a friend who lives in a flat, she should, immediately after ringing, call through the tube her name and that of the person she wishes to see. A man leaves his overcoat, hat, and stick in the hall when making an evening call. When calling in the afternoon, he leaves his overcoat in the hall, but carries his hat and stick into the drawing room with him. When a daughter is in the parlor and her mother is entertaining callers, she should rise when her mother does in bidding them good day. It is very improper for a young girl who is ill to receive men callers in her room. Cards. When an invitation to a reception is sent in the name of several women, a guest should leave or send cards for all whose names are on the invitation. A woman leaves with her own cards the cards of those members of her family who are unable to call. A young woman, when calling upon her friends with a young man who is a stranger to them, should send his card with her own to the hostess and other women of the household. In making formal calls, a visitor invariably hands her cards to the servant who opens the door with a card tray in her hand. When calling informally, one may simply give her name to the servant at the door, but then leaves no card later. A married woman, when making formal calls, leaves one of her husband's and one of her own cards for the hostess and for every other woman she asks for in the house, and one of her husband's cards, besides, for the host. But while this is the rule for formal visiting, it is quite permissible for a married woman, when calling on a number of women who reside in the same house, to leave, besides her own and her husband's for the host and hostess, only one more of each for all the others. In making formal visits and subsequent calls after the first formal visit has been made, a married woman need leave only one of her husband's cards with her own. And in making a call in acknowledgement of an invitation to an entertainment to which she alone was invited, such as a woman's luncheon, she should leave only one of her own. The fashionable visiting card varies in size, but for a married woman it is generally pure white and very thin, with the name engraved in ordinary script. For a woman who lives in the country, it is in good taste to have the name of her country place put just where, if she were in the city, her town address would be, which is in the left-hand lower corner. If a woman receives at-home cards for Tuesdays in February and is prevented from calling on any of the Tuesdays, she should send her card in an envelope, either by hand or mail, on the first Tuesday and call on the hostess at the earliest opportunity on some other day. A man should use a card engraved as Mr. George Wellington Smith, not omitting the prefix, with the address in one corner if desired. The size of the card varies from time to time, but it is smaller than a woman's card. The names of mother and daughter or daughters are often engraved on one card as Mrs. Judson Brown, Miss Anna Brown, Mrs. Judson Brown, the Mrs. Brown. The following is the usual form for an unmarried woman's card: Miss May Brown, 12 Pine Street. It is quite proper for a woman to retain her deceased husband's name on her visiting cards as Mrs. John Smith. It is equally proper for her to use Mrs. Jane Smith for the purpose. When a caller is met by the hostess at the door, she should drop her card in the card receiver or leave it on the hall table on her way out. The object of such a card is not to introduce people when visiting, but as a reminder of the visit. PPC cards should be left on the occasion of a long absence of over 3 months, on leaving town at the close of the season, on leaving a neighborhood where one has resided for years, or where one has resided for months and sometimes only for weeks, but not when changing houses in the same neighborhood, not even when about to be married, unless one's future home is to be in another city. The words pour prendre congé signify to take leave.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.